morning. We're so mad.
The book that I select is the one of the Harry Potter series, Prisoner of the Azkaban. So I'll be reading it in chapter number one, Outpost. Harry Potter was a highly unusual boy in many ways. For one thing, he hated the summer holidays more than any other time of the year. For another, he really wanted to do his homework, but was forced to do it in secret, in the dead of night. And he also happened to be a wizard. It was nearly midnight, and he was lying on his stomach in bed, the blankets drawn right over his head like a tent, flashlight in one hand, and a large leather-bound book, A History of Magic by Mathilda Bagshot, propped open against the pillow. Harry moved the tip of his eagle feather quill down the page, frowning as he looked for something that would help him write his essay. Which burning in the 14th century was completely pointless? Discuss. The quill paused at the top of a likely looking paragraph. Harry pushed his round glasses up the bridge of his nose, moved his flashlight close to the book, and read. Non-magic people, more commonly known as muggles, were particularly afraid of magic in medieval times, but not very good at recognizing it. On the rare occasion that they did catch a real witch or wizard, burning had no effect whatsoever. The witch or wizard would perform a basic flaming freezing charm and then pretend to shrink with pain while enjoying a gentle tickling sensation. Indeed, Gwendolyn the Weird enjoyed being burned so much that she allowed herself to be caught no less than 47 times in various disguises. Harry put his full between his teeth and reached underneath his pillow for his ink bottle and a roll of parchment. Slowly and very carefully, he unscrewed the ink bottle, dipped his quill into it, and began to write, pausing every now and then to listen, because if any of the Dursleys heard the scratching of his quill on their way to the bathroom, he'd probably find himself locked in the cupboard under the stairs for the rest of the summer. The Dursley family of number 4, Private Drive, was the reason that Harry never enjoyed his summer holidays. Uncle Vernon, Aunt Tina, and their son, Dudley, were Harry's only living relatives. They were muggles and they had a very venerable attitude toward magic. Harry's dead parents, who had been a witch and wizard themselves, were never mentioned under Dursley's roof. For years, Aunt Tina and Uncle Vernon had hoped that if they kept Harry as downtrodden as possible, they would be able to squash the magic power. To their fury, they had been unsuccessful. And these days, they lived in terror of anyone finding out that Harry had spent the most of the last 2 years at Hogwarts School of Witchcraft and Wizardry. The most they could do, however, was to lock away Harry's spellbooks, wand, cauldron, and broomstick at the start of the summer break, and forbid it to talk to the neighbors. This separation from his spellbooks had been a real problem for Harry, because his teachers at Hogwarts had given him a lot of holiday work. One of the essays, a particularly nasty one about shirking potions, was for Harry's least favorite teacher, Professor Snape, who would be delighted to have an excuse to give Harry detention for a month. Harry had therefore seized his chance in first week of holidays. While Uncle Vernon, Aunt Tina, and Dudley had gone out into the front garden to admire Uncle Vernon's new company car, Harry had crept downstairs, picked up the lock on the cupboard under the stairs, grabbed some of his books, and hidden them in his bed. As long as he didn't leave spots of ink on the sheets, the Dursleys need never know that he was studying magic by night. Harry was particularly keen to avoid trouble with his aunt and uncle at the moment, as they were already in an especially bad mood, all because he'd received a telephone call from a fellow wizard 1 week into his school vacation. Ron Weasley, who was one of Harry's best friends at Hogwarts, came from a whole family of wizards. This meant that he knew a lot of things that Harry didn't, but had never used a telephone before. Most unluckily, it had been Uncle Vernon who had answered the phone.
Vernon Dursley speaking.
Harry, who happened to be in the room at the time, froze as he heard Ron's voice answer.
Hello! Hello! Can you hear me? I want to talk to Harry Potter!
Ron was yelling so loudly that Uncle Vernon jumped and held the receiver a foot away from his ear, staring it with an expression of mingling fury and alarm.
Who is this?
He roared in the direction of the mouthpiece.
Who are you?
Ron Weasley!
Ron bellowed back as though he and Uncle Vernon were speaking from opposite ends of the football field.
I'm a friend of Harry's from school!
Uncle Vernon's small eyes swiveled around to Harry, who was rooted to the school.
There's no Harry Potter here!
He roared, now holding the receiver at arm's length, as though frightened it might explode.
I don't know what school you're talking about! Never contact me again! Don't you come near my family!
And he threw the receiver back onto the telephone as if dropping a poisonous spike. The fight that had followed had been one of the worst ever.
How dare you give this number to people like you!
Uncle Vernon had roared, spraying Harry with his feet. Ron obviously realized that he'd gotten Harry into trouble because he hadn't called again. Harry's other best friend from Hogwarts, Hermione, hadn't been in touch either. Harry suspected that Ron had warned Hermione not to call, which was a pity, because Hermione, the cleverest witch in Harry's year, had muggle parents knew perfectly well how to use a telephone, and would probably have had enough sense not to say that she went to Hogwarts. So Harry had had no word from any of his wizarding friends for 5 weeks, and this summer was turning out to be almost as bad as the last one. There was just one very small draft. After swearing that he wouldn't use her to send letters to any of his friends, Harry had been allowed to let his owl, Hedwig, out at night. Uncle Vernon had given in because of the racket. Hedwig had made it if she was locked in her cage all the time. Harry finished writing about the riddle and the weird and paused to listen again. The silence in the dark house was broken only by the distant grunting snores of his enormous cousin, Dudley.
It must be very late,
Harry thought. His eyes were itching with tiredness. Perhaps he'd finish this essay tomorrow night. He replaced the top of the ink bottle, pulled an old pillowcase from under his bed, put the flashlight on his story of magic, his essay quill, and ink beside him. Got out of the bed and hit a loose floorboard under his bed. Then he stood up, stretched, and checked the time on the luminous alarm clock on his bedside table. It was 1 o'clock in the morning. Harry's stomach gave a funny jolt. He had been 13 years old without realizing it for a whole hour. Yet another unusual thing about Harry was how little he looked forward to his birthdays. He had never received a birthday card in his life. The Dursleys had completely ignored his last 2 birthdays, and he had no reason to suppose they would remember this one. Harry walked across the dark room, past Hagrid's large, empty cage, to open the window. He leaned on the sill, the cool night air pleasant on his face after a long time under the blanket. Hedwig had been absent for 2 nights now. Harry wasn't worried about her. She has been gone this long before. But he hoped she'd be back soon. She was the only living creature in this house who didn't flinch at the sound. Harry, still rather small and skinny for his age, had grown a few inches over the last year. His jet black hair, however, was just as it always had been. Stubbornly untidy, whatever he did to it. The eyes behind his glasses were bright red, and on his forehead, clearly visible through his hair, was a thin scar shaped like a bolt of lightning. This is it. 그것도 다 했네. And back to Toastmaster.